It's true, not all chemicals are bad, but toxic metals like lead and mercury are found in all of us. So are persistent toxins like PCBs and endocrine disruptors such as bisphenol A and flame retardants. We've been studying the impact of toxins on children for the past 30 years and reached the inescapable conclusion: little things matter. Toxins can have a lifelong impact on children. We've also discovered that extremely low levels of toxins can impact brain development. Let's take a look at the percent of children who are exposed to some of these toxins using a national study in the United States. To keep it simple, we'll use 100 children to represent all children. Mercury is found in 89% of children, primarily from eating large fish contaminated by pollution. Lead is detected in the blood of all children, regardless of race, income, or where they live. Over 80% of children are exposed to organophosphate pesticides, mostly from food. All children are exposed to PCBs, a persistent pollutant that was banned in the 70s, but will linger for generations. Bisphenol A, or BPA, is found in 96% of children. PBDEs, a type of flame retardant, are found in 100% of children. But these toxins don't occur in isolation. Children are exposed to many toxins and dozens of untested chemicals all the time. Let's take a look at the body burden of a typical child, one toxin at a time. If each marble represents one part per billion of a toxin, this figure represents the body burden of a typical child. One part per billion is deceptively small. It is only about 2 tablespoons of sugar in an Olympic-sized swimming pool. But chemicals can be biologically active, even at very low levels. The chemical industry has tried to assure us that concentrations of these toxins are too small to cause harm. But chemicals designed by drug companies to alter behavior, like the prescribed dose of Ritalin, a drug commonly used to treat children with ADHD, is active at levels about the same or even lower than toxins found in the blood. Besides, a lot of studies have shown that some chemicals can be toxic, even at very low levels. As the body burden of PBDEs in pregnant women increases, the intellectual ability of their children decreases. Let's take a closer look. As the level of PBDEs in mothers' blood increases from 10 to 100 parts per billion, the IQ scores of their children drop by about 5 points. We see a similar pattern with organophosphate pesticides. As the level of organophosphate pesticides in pregnant women increases from 10 to 75 parts per billion, the IQ scores of their children drop by about 5 points. In the 1960s, hundreds of children died from severe lead poisoning every summer. Since then, much lower levels of exposure have been shown to result in learning deficits and brain disorders like ADHD. In fact, the World Health Organization and other agencies agree there is no safe level of lead exposure. As the level of lead in children's blood increases from 0 to 100 parts per billion, IQ scores drop by about 6 points. In contrast, an increase from 100 to 200 parts per billion results in an IQ drop of 2 more points. An increase from 200 to 300 parts per billion results in an IQ drop of another point. The impact of toxins on the developing brain is permanent. Children who are more heavily exposed to toxins won't reach the same peak cognitive ability as those who have lower exposures. These studies show that there is no safe level of exposure. They also indicate that the way we regulate toxins, which assumes there is a safe level, fails to protect children. The chemical industry argues that the effect of toxins on children is subtle and of little consequence. But that's misleading. Little shifts in children's IQ scores have a big impact on the number of children who are challenged or gifted. Let's go back to our original sample of 100 children and look at a typical distribution of IQ scores. Most of us have IQ scores that fall between 85 and 115 points. Only 2.5% of children have an IQ above 130, which is considered gifted. There are about 6 million children in this group. On the other end of the distribution, another 2.5% of children have an IQ below 70, which is considered challenged. The impact of exposure to a toxin like lead causes a 5-point drop in IQ. This shift results in a 57% increase in the number of children that are challenged, from 6 million to 9.4 million. There is a corresponding decrease in the number of children that are gifted, from 6 million to 2.4 million. Little shifts matter. The impact of exposure to another toxin, like flame retardants, results in a further increase in the number of children who are challenged, from 9.4 million to over 11 million. There is a further decrease in the number of gifted children. Although many, or even most, chemicals are harmless, the cumulative impact of exposures to three or four toxins is overwhelming to imagine. In Canada and the United States, chemicals are used in consumer products and released into the environment before they are tested for toxic effects. By allowing children to be exposed to toxins or chemicals of unknown toxicity, we are unwittingly using our children as part of a massive experiment. But it doesn't have to be this way. Like the European Union, we could require industry to prove that the chemicals they use aren't toxic before they enter the market. How can we avoid exposures to toxins or chemicals of unknown toxicity? The ultimate solution is to revise how we regulate chemicals. Consider writing a letter to your government representative and urge them to require industry to test their products before they are put on the market. There are a few simple ways you can reduce your child's exposure to toxins. Eat fresh or frozen foods. If possible, choose organic. Try to avoid canned foods and steer clear of heavily processed foods. If you are pregnant or planning to become pregnant, eat fish low in mercury. Don't use pesticides in and around your home. Check your home for lead hazards, especially if it was built before 1960. Frequent cleaning of floors and surfaces can help reduce children's exposures to lead, flame retardants, and other toxins in house dust.
Welcome to the Functional Forum. Thanks for joining us in the charge to accelerate the evolution of medicine. Now, here's your host, James Maskell.
What's up, everyone? Welcome to the Functional Forum. It's a rowdy crowd. It's a holiday party. Why do so many people just come out for the holiday party? We got the record attendance tonight. Great for you all to be here. If you saw a little bit of the intro, this time last year we just had a party and you can see Anthony Whitehurst, who's one of our employees. He was the guy doing the break dancing. But we've gone another level up this year to have a show, because this is actually our last monthly show in New York. So in 2016, we're going to be taking the show on the road, and we're going to be once a quarter here in New York, and we're the other two times a quarter we're going to be on the road. So in January, we're going to be in Orange County, California. And in February, we're going to be in Boulder, Colorado. There will be meetups in New York. There's one with Chema Wellness, who are in the house tonight. And there's going to be many more around Brooklyn, the Bronx. So you will be well taken care of here in New York. We have got an awesome show for you this evening. I can feel a bit of a rant brewing. I'm not sure how that's going to come out, but I think it's going to come out anytime soon. But let's start with some... some exciting news. So who saw Doctor in the House with Dr. Rangan Chatterjee? I illegally streamed it on my Periscope for people who follow me on Periscope. But it was the most amazing show I've ever seen. So Rangan, the reviews weren't great, I have to say. And that was annoying because I don't think the British people really know what empathy is. He was very empathetic and it was like, look, you have type 2 diabetes. Is it that much of a stretch to walk a little bit or other things? And, people were saying, like, I wouldn't want a doctor like this to come and live in my house, but you don't have type 2 diabetes, right? And it was amazing. So this was the family the first time. I mean, this was taken basically after they were all well. She looked $1 million after 30 days. He reversed his type 2 diabetes. These all of these people. She reversed her type 2 diabetes. The other guy got of his opioid addiction. The child got rid of his eczema, all in 30 days, all live broadcast to 7 million people. So everyone's happy, right? Of course, everyone's happy. What a great show. The British Dietetic Association are not happy. Right? Because according to UK Diabetes UK guidelines, everyone with diabetes should receive individual and ongoing dietary nutrition advice from a dietitian. Have we heard this before? Have you guys heard this before? So look, I'm not going to pick on dietitians right now because some of my favorite providers are dietitians. Ashley Koff, Jerry Brewster, Laura Lagana, who comes here. These are passionate people. But it brings together a bigger point, and I want to talk about this because the biggest thing that we have going for us at the Functional Forum right now is community. It's you guys here in the room in the New York community, and it's the 200 communities of practitioners all across the world watching this show. Now, what I hear from some people is that at some of these communities, there's this same kind of thing going on with other practitioners thinking they're better or otherwise, and it's not dietitians versus naturopaths versus coaches always. Like in medical school, the neurologists don't think much of the primary care doctors. And this, look, if that's the way you think about medicine, that's fine, but this is not the crew for you. Go and find your own thing. In our thing, it's going to be a meritocracy. And it's a meritocracy because guess what? Rangan Chatterjee was reversing chronic diseases live. And if that makes you feel uncomfortable, then you should be, because otherwise your profession is moribund. I love that word, but it's true. I've been waiting to use that word on my show for a long time. It's a classic Partridge line. So look, this is going to come to BBC America next year. It's awesome. I'm sure with the success of it on social media, maybe the American networks are going to pick it up. Maybe not. Depends how they're advertising. I don't know if you saw also, but in the last month, the AMA have said that they don't think pharma advertising on TV is a good idea. So the world is changing. Let's have a round of applause for that. Oh, that's my dietitian round. Look, dietitians, you are welcome to be part of the Functional Forum community. Thank you for doing what you do, but this is bullshit. Right. Okay. So community is the guru of the future, and that's what I talk about. And I'll give you an example of how this community is changing the world in a very different way. There are two naturopathic doctors that come to this meeting all the time, Dr. Millie Lytle and Dr. Patricia Pimentel. They are creating a training to teach naturopathic principles to health coaches. So they're integrating, you know, this world in cool ways. And that's the kind of collaboration that we love at the Functional Forum. I'd like to think that's the kind of collaboration we've inspired at the Functional Forum, and that's the kind of thing that we want to see, because community is the guru of the future, and that's a fact. So tonight we're going to be talking about detox to retox, and it's an exciting time to talk about toxicity, because we talked about this last month. If you were here, you heard the Endocrine Society, their executive summary, the Endocrine Society's second scientific statement on endocrine disrupting chemicals. I got into a bit of an internet battle with a friend of mine who I would call an allopath, but I don't use that word everywhere else because it doesn't mean anything to anyone else. But she was like, she was so glad that the Endocrine Society was spearheading this movement. And I was like, I don't think you get to call it spearheading if you show up 30 years late to the party and it's not a part of your thing, but I'm glad that we're all on the same page and we were right. Right? So, you know, so that's that. And then this was in the New York Times last week, contaminating our bodies with everyday products. It was awesome. And it was written, and it was, and it talked about not only the endocrine disrupting, but it also talked about the Endocrine Society, but it also talked about the International Federation of Gynecology and Obstetrics. So this is an exciting time, you know, this is reaching the mainstream. You know, for how long have we had, you know, naysayers talking about the fact that what are these toxins? You know, this was like, you know, all the toxins that were part of like homeopathic or naturopathic principles, you know, these were built into the actual principles of these organizations. They were like, what are these mystery toxins? Yeah, were you watching the video earlier? It's lead and it's mercury. Like these things have names and you can look it up if you bother to look, and it's real. And so then you see, obviously, the fight back from science-based medicine. And we have the chemical hypocrisy of food babe, Joseph McCullough and Mark Hyman. Now, if you read that article, there are two things going on. Look, one, I think what you're seeing here, this is a kind of a hit piece that would go out anyway, whatever, right? Because you're ruffling the feathers, and that's going to happen. But at the same time, look, you can't, there were things that they cited in there, like, some supplement that Mark Hyman sells has one of the agreements he rails against. Look, I think it's a some of it was a fair point in that we need to up the integrity of everyone, right? We can't sell products that have crap in it if we're going to tell people you shouldn't buy crap. So you need to be really clear about, you know, we need to set a higher standard. But at the same time, all of these people, all these three, I have an enormous amount of respect for, because they were sticking their neck out before it was cool. And now it's going to be cool and everyone's going to jump on the bandwagon. But it took some real guts to do it up until now, and I have a lot of respect for that. So, you know, I don't know if you were watching earlier. You guys were chatting a lot, but hopefully at home you're watching very intently. But we had a badass video on at the beginning. There was a cool thing in the Huffington Post. It says, for every $1 spent to protect kids from lead, according to a study in 2009, society saves $17 to $220. Now, and it says, thanks to reduced costs of healthcare, special education, crime, lost lifetime earnings for those with IQ losses or disorders such as autism and ADHD. What? Autism and toxicity? I've never heard that one before. But look, you can see that going up here. And what they show is it's the bell curve, right? You add one bit of toxin and everyone moves left a little bit on the bell curve, and you end up with a ton more people challenged and very few people gifted. This is happening. This is a fact. And so we need to start dealing with it. And, you know, if you're going to talk about people spearheading it, talk about the naturopathic profession. This is part of the ingrained part of their profession forever. But if you're going to look at an organization that might have been dealing with this for a long time, I think we've been doing pretty well on it. You know, we had, this is Heather White here talking a year and a half ago at ABC Home with Frank Littman. She's the director of the Environmental Working Group. This is their new logo up here. Bob Rowntree, we did a session with him as part of our IFM collaboration. You can go and watch it on our YouTube channel. That was awesome. We had Latham Thomas here to talk about her thing with the Environmental Working Group, which was a guide to a non-toxic pregnancy. You can watch that on YouTube. And I wanted to welcome, and let's bring the chairs up here for a minute, our first guest. I'm just going to do a little interview with her because I think she's really fabulous. She's got one of the best TED Talks that I've seen. She made a film called Toxic Baby, and she's been on this for a long time, and I'd love to hear her thoughts, and I know you will too, on what she's doing. It's welcome Penelope Jagessa Schaefer. We're gonna have a little chat. Welcome, big round of applause here. Penelope, if you haven't watched the TED Talk, you got to go and check it out, because it was beautiful. And it was one of the things when I was sort of in the trenches of medicine and realizing that most doctors didn't realize that this was a thing, you know, seeing things like your TED Talk really, you know, I think kept us all going. So what are your thoughts on this new these new pronouncements by the OBGYN and the Endocrine Society as far as the whole movement of understanding toxins as playing a role in chronic pediatric and regular health?
Well, you know, first of all, it has to be welcomed, because they're a long time coming to the table. And I think that their endorsement really shows that we've reached a point where we have to start accepting the science. So I think that's great. The problem that I have is that it's a little late. And the interesting thing is that whilst we think things are getting better because we have the Endocrine Society coming to the table, and they're a great organization, I do a lot of work with them. The problem is that actually what the science is showing is that the problem is much more complicated and even worse in some cases than we think.
Can you give us an example of that?
Yeah, absolutely. Not too long ago, a study was published by a really interesting researcher, a Spanish researcher called Angel Nadal. He actually does a lot of work with diabetes, and he started looking at BPA, and what he found was that BPA triggers estrogen receptivity differently depending on where in the cell the estrogen receptor is. And estrogen receptors in the nucleus are triggered in a much more significant way than anywhere else. So in other words, it's almost as if it's a higher dosage of estrogen. Hmm. Now that is mind-blowing when you think of the FDA, for example, regulating BPA in water containers and baby bottles and things like that. It's based on the current research that we have, which suggests that BPA isn't that estrogenic. It's not that bad an estrogen.
Yeah.
But it also is challenging because you ask the question, can you extrapolate that out to other chemicals that have endocrine disrupting abilities, like phthalates, for example? There's no reason to suggest that that may not also be the case. So what we're seeing, and there's also some really good research coming out that shows that the way that we've been looking at the metabolites of BPA has not been technically correct in terms of liver function. And so that suggests that it's actually a lot worse than it is. The other thing I want to mention really quickly is the idea of replacements. So we have this great awareness, and this is amazing, and then we have what I call the free movement, the free economic movement, BPA free. So BPA has got to be replaced with something because it's really awful, and everybody goes out and buys the replacement, but BPA is replaced with BPF or BPS, with the same bisphenol molecule.
Yeah.
And in fact, there's an A to Z of bisphenol molecules. You can get bisphenol Z, for example.
Yeah.
And so whilst we're thinking this is really great and the awareness is fantastic and we're taking all of this stuff out, what are we putting in to replace these things? Because the expectation as a consumer is that if you're going to give me something that still works in the same way, it's going to work in the same way. So you're taking stuff out, it still has to be the same thing. I mean, you mentioned Food Babe, Subway took the yoga mat chemical out, but Subway bread still behaves in the same way, still looks the same way, it still tastes the same way. So what did they replace that with?
Can't imagine. The smell is weird, isn't it, when you walk past a Subway? You know, I was traveling in Europe with a friend who's from the south, and he's like, oh, I love that smell of Subway. And it's like, to me, it was the same as Bed Bath and Beyond, I feel like. You know, one of the things that came out from the Endocrine Society that I thought was super interesting was this transgenerational. They're talking about transgenerational effects. So it's not just your effect on your endocrine system, but it's going to be, you know, your kids and potentially your grandkids. And, you know, I see, like the grandkids of people that we sprayed with Agent Orange in Vietnam. I mean, that is harrowing. What are we doing right now? I mean, what are we doing to my grandkids?
Well, this is absolutely the case. And I have to say that the medical community has known about transgenerational effects for a while. Thalidomide is a transgenerational effect. And if you look at a chemical compound called DES, diethyl sulbestrol, widely administered in the US and Australia and the UK to prevent miscarriage during the 50s, 60s, and early 70s, the babies looked fine, so there wasn't an obvious defect like there was with thalidomide. What happened actually is that they started realizing that the second generation were developing really rare cancers. The girls were developing cancers like cancer of the vagina, which is extraordinarily rare, early in life, uterine cancer early in life, ovarian cancer early in life, which is quite unheard of. We're now seeing the third generation of these children, of the third generation from the original grandmothers who were exposed. And they're developing ovarian cancers at a younger age. We're now seeing teenagers. And no one is talking about this stuff. And the medical community was aware of that because they stopped prescribing it to pregnant women in the 1970s. It's not banned, and it's still used as a treatment for prostate cancer and other weird, I think it's also used in the cattle industry or something weird like that. But we've known about this, so we're very selective in where we cast our eye.
Yeah, it's very sad. So Penelope will be available for questions later on the panel. If you haven't watched the Toxic Baby video, I definitely watch it. This is relevant today, if not more relevant than any time before. Any seeds of hope on the horizon apart from these kind of things? I mean, do you see hope moving forward that we're going to see some change or some progress?
Absolutely. I mean, I think the thing is, one of the reasons why people have come to the table is because everyone's so sick. There's so much illness, and chronic disease for children has become so epidemic. And so I think that unfortunately the motivation to get a lot of people here isn't great, but the fact that people are coming to the table together is absolutely brilliant. And I think ultimately we force, maybe is not the right word, but I think we encourage everyone to come on board. You know, the chemical industry, multi-billion dollar industry, has gotten away with a lot for a long time, and I think the accountability starts here.
Seems to me the biggest problem across hospitalists, insurance, pharma, chemical, whatever, is the fiduciary responsibility. Any CEO that comes in with a conscience is like, hey, I want to change this, you know, short-term shareholder gain goes down, he gets voted out, a new guy who's going to maximize profits. I mean, to me that seems like a big hurdle.
Well, that's why you have to disrupt the stock market.
All right. Well, Penelope's thoughts on that coming later. Let's have a round of applause for Penelope. She'll be back later. It's an epic TED Talk. You got to check it out. She'll be back later for the panel. So there's a guy that you should be following on social media, and his name's Dr. Sachin Patel. He's awesome. And he wrote this the other day, and it was perfect in alignment for this. He said, the only reason you need to keep detoxing is because you keep retoxing. Now, he didn't know that Dr. Drew Ramsey was going to be doing his detox, retox shots out there, but he was talking about in general. He said, don't expect to get healthy by yo-yo cleansing. Commit to making lifelong sustainable changes instead of micro bursts of ridiculousness. That is a British, awesome phrase. He's Canadian, so he's a bit British, but I love that. He says, after all, it's about consistency, that it's consistency that carves canyons, not the storm. I love that. And Become Proof is his hashtag. You should follow him on social media. He's a great dude. And Max posted this the other day, good friend of mine, Max Lugavere, and hopefully some of that brain information was awesome and can go in your film. But you know, you posted this the other day and I was like, look, this is our thing. Detoxing's our thing. We've been made fun of for years for detoxing chemicals that don't exist, and now they realize that it does exist. This is our thing. And this is a quote from Hillel the Elder, popularized by JFK, and he said, if not us, who, and if not now, when? Come on, it's our time to shine. You know, the beauty of functional medicine, doctor, it's a massive improvement on primary care, but it's also the, you know, it's chronic disease management, it's chronic disease prevention, it's all specialists and generalists thrown into one super power practitioner, and so we need to start acting like it. And I've said this from the beginning, we've got to start acting like we're winning, start acting like we're losing, and hopefully this is the beginning of it. So, at the beginning of the Functional Forum, the third ever Functional Forum, right here in the front, Dr. Kelly Brogan gave a talk on the evolution of psychiatry, and also on the panel that day was Dr. Jeffrey Morrison, one of my favorite doctors here in New York. He's been practicing integrative and environmental medicine for 10 years, and I've been trying to find a way to get him to come and speak at the Functional Forum, and I'm so glad he's agreed to come and keynote. So we'll have a warm round of applause for Dr. Jeffrey Morrison.
Hey, thank you very much, James. I've been actually waiting to be invited for years. Thank you for finally having me, and it's great to be here in front of everybody talking about the topic that I think we're all so interested in because it's timely and it's real. You know, I'm not going to get into a lot of details about toxins because I think we all sort of have been hearing enough about the toxins in our environment. And really, I want to talk about solutions. So even though we'll talk a little bit about what the toxins are, we really want to focus more on what to do about it. So I've been practicing in New York City for over 10 years now, and I sort of got started in environmental medicine through a personal experience that I had while I was in medical school. And you know, on a medical school doctor's budget, I was eating a lot of tuna fish twice a day, every day for many years. Next thing you know, my memory was not as good as I could remember, and I was starting to get tremors, and my fatigue was increasing. And there was no answers in medical school for this. But fortunately, during my residency, I met a doctor that was a family practice doc in right outside of Harrisburg, Pennsylvania. And his name was John Sullivan, and he did environmental medicine. And through some testing, we found out that my mercury levels in my blood were through the roof, and we started a detoxification process that helped tremendously. And ever since then, I realized that it's very important to find the underlying cause of a person's problems, and once you find that problem, there's lots to do about it. So we're going to talk about a little bit about my experience in environmental medicine, what I've experienced, the most successful strategies for helping like 75% of my patients. And then at the end, I want to get into a new technique that we're starting to use for our patients that are the most challenging, that I think that we all might want to find out about, that you may end up using at your practice, but we're starting to use it ours. So what we're talking about, what the toxin, how do you know what the toxin is, how does it affect our health, and what are we going to do about it? So just very simply stated, toxins basically adversely affect our health. And we know from the literature that there are thousands of toxins in the environment, and there are more being created every single day, and it's impossible to keep up with what they are. All we can only hope for is that we can improve our body's innate ability to detoxify itself, and of course, make better choices so we're decreasing our exposure. The toxins that come from outside of our body come from air, food, water, and skincare products. So from that perspective, we know we want to make better choices. But there's also toxins that come from inside the body. And I think a lot of professionals are not always aware of this, especially when you consider that emotions can have an adverse effect on toxicity, because when people are in an anger state, they're basically in the fight or flight response, and the body can only really detoxify when it's in its parasympathetic, rest, relaxed, and detoxification state. But also, infections like Lyme disease and mycoplasma and parasites, which cause inflammation in the digestive tract, and also hormone imbalances, not only because of the skincare products that we're using, but also because the foods that we're eating have estrogenic effects, which then cause hormone imbalances. And then, you know, then how about allergies today? It, basically, like 70% of my patient population has environmental allergies, or food allergies, or gluten sensitivity. And what's wonderful about living in New York City is that the servers are so up on this. They always ask you, so are there any food allergies at the table? And if you say no, they're actually shocked. So thank goodness for New York City. And this is where detoxification comes in. It's partly about understanding where the toxin is and then getting rid of the inflammation. So just like leaves can clog up a gutter, toxins can clog up our detoxification capacity. And what this happens on the cellular level is literally cells are not able to get nutrition or oxygen, and then the cells become dysfunctional. And when the cells are becoming dysfunctional, that's when we are not making energy properly. I like to say that toxicity causes inflammation, inflammation causes poor circulation causes poor oxygenation, and then poor oxygenation causes poor mitochondrial function. And when you think about it, when you have poor mitochondrial function, your body can't make ATP properly. Normally, our body takes one glucose molecule with oxygen and we can make about 38 ATP. But without oxygen, we can only make 2 ATP, which means that when you're not oxygenating your cells properly, you're only running at about 19%, or you're running 19 times less efficient. And that's why there's so many people out there with chronic fatigue and fibromyalgia. It's because they are not oxygenating their cells. And essentially, this catch-all term of mitochondrial dysfunction is really a toxicity issue, in my opinion. So how do you know you or your patients need to detox? It would be great if there was a gauge that would just show us. But what we use in our office is a symptom survey. And this symptom survey is used count... Oh, these are the symptoms that usually people have with toxicity, like fatigue, difficulty concentrating, poor memory, digestive symptoms. And then what we use is this symptom survey, which we have on our website, and we are welcome anybody to use. We generally have people fill out the symptom survey when they first come into the office so that we can get a baseline. And then we have them fill it out after they go through our program so that they can see subjectively how much their symptoms improve. So this is a article that I published in 2012, which just talked about my clinical experience with using a meal replacement enhanced detoxification process. And what we did is we had people fill out a symptom survey when they first came to the office, they followed our program, and then they filled out the symptom survey at the end. And after 4 weeks, what the patients found and what we found was that they felt 66% better after doing 4 weeks of the program. And truly, that's what we want as clinicians, is to help our patients to feel better. And if they wanted to lose weight, they also lost about 9 pounds, which is not so bad. And probably a lot of that was just water weight, because we know that people with toxicity hold on to a lot of fluid. I wanted to give a little case study about one of the patients that went through this process, because I think this is something that each one of the healthcare providers watching could potentially use in their own practice, which is, it's very simple. And again, this is what I use that helps with 75% of our patients. And all we really are doing is just changing their lifestyle. This is like helping with the transition. It's, we call it a detox process, but really it's a sneaky way to get people to start a transition to a healthy lifestyle. So this was a female attorney slash lobbyist who wanted to lose weight and improve her menopause symptoms. But the, on her symptom survey, her biggest symptoms included fatigue, carb cravings, hot flashes, night sweats, difficulty sleeping, low mood, and memory changes. And on her symptom survey, the goal is to score under 14. She scored a 67. Her weight was 148 pounds, but her goal was 130. And she basically had the standard American diet. We always try to find out sources of toxic exposure. So what she explained was that, you know, she was eating the standard American diet. She was using personal care products that were basically full of preservatives and phthalates and parabens. And she was eating lots of tuna fish, and I had personal experience with that. And she had stress from her father's illness. So we started her on a program, so which basically is using a protein shake as a meal replacement, a shake and a salad for lunch, protein and vegetables for dinner. I think by now almost everybody here has had some experience with this. We address the sources of her exposure. We recommended she start exercising, have the goal of sleeping about 7 to 8 hours a night, and follow up in 4 weeks. And after 4 weeks, we found she basically said, well, I'm starting to feel better. And on her symptom survey, her symptoms improved over 50%. From 67 to 32, she lost about 8 pounds. And on her blood work, we found that, lo and behold, she has gluten sensitivity and her blood mercury is about 25. For those that don't do a lot of blood work, the goal is under 10 based on the reference range, but our goal is under 2. And she said, I'm feeling so great, I want to keep on going. So after 9 weeks, no hot flashes, no night sweats, her memory is better, energy and sleep have all improved, and now her symptom survey is down to a 10, and she's almost at her goal weight. So, you know, the bottom line is sometimes it can be really simple to get a person to feel great, to get their energy back, get their digestive symptoms improved, get rid of their hot flashes and night sweats. And it can just start with just the nutritional basics. And of course, you know, sort of we sort of create a structure to this. We like to replace unhealthy foods with healthier options. We remove toxins, and I'm going to get into a little bit how we do that. And then we replenish nutritional deficiencies. I think we're all kind of aware of the toxins in packaged and processed foods, and we like to replace them with much cleaner options. We love the environmental groups, Clean 15 and Dirty Dozen. It comes into play so many times, and I'm handing out this food list very frequently. But as far as detoxification, this is where we want to take an active stance. And I took a picture of, this is a picture of me running the Fifth Avenue Mile in under 6 minutes. And the point is that exercise is detoxification. Because when you're sweating, you're removing toxins. When you're breathing and moving your muscles, you're literally pumping your lymphatic system, which returns toxins back to your bloodstream, which then allows your liver and kidney to process the toxins more efficiently. And of course, we want to make sure that we're eliminating properly as well. For those of you that still are wondering whether you can actually sweat out toxins, this was a nice article in 2012 that showed that in sweat, there was high levels of mercury, arsenic, cadmium. And what the authors of this study suggested is that physicians should recommend sweating as tolerated via exercise or use a sauna as a low-risk, potentially beneficial treatment for individuals who may be experiencing effects of toxic elements. So that could be Swedish sauna or infrared sauna or exercise. And then we always like to replenish nutritional deficiencies. And the ones that I find are the biggest issues are mineral imbalances. And especially, of course, magnesium, which we're all aware of, but also zinc and selenium, manganese and molybdenum. And the reason those are important is because these are the minerals that are important for helping to make intracellular antioxidants like superoxide dismutase and glutathione peroxidase, and also they help with improving the body's innate detoxification capacity. So basically what we've talked about is how to use a symptom survey, how to just put a person on a detox program, by replacing unhealthy foods with healthier options, removing toxins through breathing, sweating, and eliminating, and then replenishing nutritional deficiencies. And this works about 75% of the time. But for those really stubborn cases, what we found recently, for those people that can't get inflammation under control and you have no idea what else to do, we're finding two techniques that are basically similar applications of a process called low-dose antigen therapy and low-dose immunotherapy, which is coming from work that was done in the 1960s by a British researcher named Dr. McEwen. And what he found is that an enzyme called beta-glucuronidase, when used with when applied with an antigen like pollen or foods or mold, it helps to improve the regulation of the immune response against whatever the immune system is adversely reacting to. And so that original application was called enzyme potentiated desensitization. It was brought to the United States and was practiced up until the early 1990s. The FDA shut it down. There was a new United States doctor named Dr. Butch Schrader that took over the work. It's called low-dose antigen therapy. He's worked with a compounding pharmacy in Colorado called College Pharmacy, where he makes his antigens. He sells the beta-glucuronidase, and he uses those applications together to turn off chronic food allergies, chronic environmental allergies, chronic chemical sensitivities. And then recently, 2 years ago, an Alaskan doctor named Ty Vincent discovered that he could also apply that same technology to chronic infections, like chronic Lyme disease, mycoplasma pneumonia, and other infections that have a molecular mimicry effect on the body's immune response to itself, where he's able to shut off rheumatoid arthritis, Sjogren's, lupus, and Crohn's, and ulcerative colitis. So for when you think you don't know what to do next, there's still hope. And speaking of hope, Mother Teresa, I think, sums it up best. Together we can do great things. And that's kind of what the Functional Forum is all about. And we appreciate the opportunity to come here, work together with our colleagues, and make new friends, and learn about what we do together. And together we can make it better. So thank you all very much for listening.
Awesome. Thanks, Dr. Morrison. Dr. Morrison will be on the panel later, and you can ask him questions. So get the questions coming in on Twitter. You can use hashtag Functional Forum, and we'll take some questions from Twitter. We'll take some questions from the team here. That was, what I really wanted to see is, like, what do the most people do? Because, like, I know there's going to be people watching be like, yeah, I know how to do detox. They've done it before. But the truth is, we need a lot more practitioners to do this because we've got a toxic 300 million people population. And so that's another reason why we really have to be inclusive of those practitioners that have taken the effort to be able to become practitioners doing functional nutrition, doing these kind of other modalities, because we need them, because they can do this too. And I love what you said, Doc, about, tricking people into lifestyle changes by calling it a detox. I mean, we need to get people to do lifestyle changes. If that's what it takes, that's what it takes. And that's a good way to do it. So we're getting a lot of good stuff here. So I want to talk about some top tech tools for practitioners. And to come back to this, I've been speaking about this a little bit. New York City's biggest integrative health symposium. It's been going for 10 years. The Evolution of Medicine is going to be doing some really cool stuff there this year. It's the 26th to the 28th of February in New York City. Come and hang out with us. There will be the Evolution of Medicine Technology Suite, and you can come and hang out with us. We may or may not have a DJ, but we will have all kinds of awesome technologies that help to increase the efficiency of chronic disease delivery through functional integrated medicine. Functional integrated medicine is not efficient enough to serve 300 million people right now, but it will be if we start using some of the things we're about to talk about. So one of the technologies, and they're a sponsor of the show, is HealthWave. They now offer a 40% margin on your supplements. We just did some things with them. Basically, I think for most practitioners, if you're starting an integrated micro practice from scratch, you need to reduce your overhead in every way possible, and running an inventory is not not something that anyone's taught in school. And HealthWave has a really good system for being able to use it. A lot of top practitioners use it. You can get all the brands from 275 brands. They got 20,000 SKUs. Go evomed.com/healthwave. Igbo, people are loving a bit of Igbo. It's not available in the major markets yet, like New York and San Francisco, but this is the Uber for phlebotomists. And you can, instead of, if you're using complex labs like Cyrex or Genova or any of these functional diagnostics, even to do the kind of toxicity test that Dr. Morrison is talking about, you can have a little Iggy, which is their little phlebotomist that goes in basically an Uber car, come and go to their house and go, and it takes the compliance on tests from 50% to over 98%. So, you know, this is an increasingly powerful tool, and guess what? The lab pays for it, so it doesn't cost the patient or the doctor. We also have bodysite.com. We've got a lot of practitioners using BodySite right now. You know, if you hire a health coach, that's great. And health coaches and doctors, or dietitians and doctors, or functional nutritionists and doctors working together is a beautiful match. But if you're a doctor watching this and you want to be able to recommend a gluten-free diet, as I've said before, you recommend a dietary change, that doesn't mean they're going to change their diet. There's like 100 things that have to happen for people to change their diet. They have to buy different things. They have to learn how to cook new meals. This is what BodySite provides. So for a low monthly fee, you can essentially just have all of these, you know, all of these recipes and so forth sent if you want to do AIP or paleo or gluten-free, and they provide all of that support. So it's almost like you as an individual practitioner now have a team of nutritionists on staff, and we've had a lot of great feedback on that. We've also talked about telemedicine. You know, I can't believe that more functional doctors aren't doing telemedicine. The demand for functional medicine is so outstripping supply that, like, if you're a functional medicine doctor, you could be getting patients from everywhere in the state. And Igbo, not only, there's so many benefits of it, but one, it runs on the internet. It runs on a web browser, right? The reason why everyone uses Skype is because everyone's got Skype, right? And you don't have to download the thing. The downloading stuff for old people is not going to happen, right? So you have to have an easy system. This runs in your internet browser, super easy to use. If they, you know, they just offer a ton of customer service. If you look at everything that we offer, it's like, who's got good customer service and who helps you out? But if you go to goevomed.com/chiron, book a demo. This is a super powerful software. I see more and more functional doctors who are going to minimize their days in the office, going to 1 or 2 days a week in the office to see new patients, doing all of their follow-up with Chiron, doing all of their e-supplement prescribing with HealthWave. Their overhead has gone down dramatically. And that's what we need to get more and more doctors doing it. The overhead has to come down. And, you know, compare $150 a month to Chiron to another room or another front desk person. I mean, the costs are just, it's a joke. So this is serious. And Chris Kresser, who we're going to hopefully have on the forum this year. Chris, if you're watching, watch out. I'm coming for you. But Chris, you know, we spoke to him about it, and he just said, look, he used Skype, he used Zoom, and it was a complete nightmare. And then he went to a HIPAA-compliant service like Chiron, and now it's working out great. And, you know, I talked earlier about community is the guru of the future. And I just want to talk about one thing with detoxes, because Dr. Shilpa Saxena, who we've had on the forum, she talks about this group visit model, right? So instead of going, seeing everyone for 7 minutes each, maybe you want to do it in a group. Now, this is a brilliant idea, but in order to do it on insurance, it does take a little bit of finagling. You can do it, and people do it, and it's awesome. And that's how I would suggest that, you know, you could really start to make a difference. But I want to challenge everyone here right now is that we're in December. And the reason why we did the detox one in December, it's not intuitive to do in December because everyone's retoxing, right? Between Halloween and Thanksgiving and Christmas, you got a sugar, you know, a sugar quarter, basically, of the year. So this is the retoxing part. But what I'm telling you now is that all of your practices will get an influx of tons of people in January and April. Set yourself right. And why not use this opportunity to try a group program? Right? There is so much power in the group, because guess what? You don't have to do all the heavy lifting, because you set one person up with another person and they're accountability buddies, and they do the heavy lifting with each other. This peer-to-peer support is really what is the most inexhaustible resource in medicine. If you haven't tried doing a group visit, do a group detox. 10 years ago, when I was a supplement rep, everyone was doing the group detox, and it was easy to do. And I would say that if you're a practitioner, just get it starting out. It brings down the cost for everyone involved. involved. There's the accountability and support. And what you might learn from doing it is that groups are awesome and you might think you want to do more groups. And I hope that you do, because we need to make this type of medicine accessible to everyone. And a group detox kind of thing, or a group model, is a way that you can bring down the cost and have everyone have access to these kind of principles where you don't have to spend 2 hours with an expensive doctor. This is the way that it's going to roll out. So use detox as an opportunity to do that. And I just want to mention Freedom Practice Coaching is another sponsor. And one of the reasons why we like Freedom Practice Coaching is they have all sorts of systems to take advantage of the power of the group. You know, they were the ones who told us about the idea of taking a group of patients around the grocery store together, and not at the time when the grocery store's empty, at prime time when everyone's doing it, because nothing's more remarkable than seeing a group of patients being walked around by a doctor or a health coach or a dietitian telling them how to shop in the local supermarket. So one, we knew that FPC was going to be a good fit for us because they did that. If you go to goevomed.com/FPC, you know, check out what they're doing. They've got some new trainings coming up next year where it's a 2-day thing rather than a 3-year thing. And if you're good at implementing, maybe that's going to be a good fit for you. So we'd love to take some more questions coming up here now. So earlier in the year, we had Andre Nakayama come and speak at the Functional Forum. Very well received. We got so much good feedback on here. And then a couple of months ago, I was with Andre, and she was speaking at a conference called the Thyroid Mastermind in Boulder. And she hit on a couple of topics that I think are absolutely crucial. And I asked her to come and speak about it on the Functional Forum, because I feel like a big part of taking patients through a healing process is having empathy in the face of who knows what the patient is going to do when you start detoxing. I mean, I'm sure all of you who are working, that it changes their behavior, it changes their relationships, it changes their lifestyle. You've got to sort of provide a little bit of a support for them. And she talked about that, and I was like, we have to have that on the Functional Forum. And if you're a great detoxer and you've been doing functional medicine for a long time, and you don't think you can learn anything clinical more about detoxing, I'm absolutely sure that you can learn from Andrea. She's a great educator. I'm glad to have you back. Let's have a round of applause for Andrea Nakayama.
Hi, I'm so excited to be back here today. I'm going to talk a little bit about the hero's journey, which I spoke about the last time I was here at Functional Forum, but I have to go through my own hero's journey to get here every time. So the first time I came, my luggage was lost. This time my flight was canceled. I'm coming from Portland, Oregon, and I'm here and so excited to be with all of you in New York City. So I'm glad to be here. And tonight what I want to talk about is how you can be the detoxification agent for your most toxic patients. And what does it mean to have toxic patients? Now, of course, we have a flood of all the toxins that we've been talking about this evening that are impacting us physiologically, but those come with emotions, and those come with a lot of things that we need to be thinking about as we're working with this population. So I don't know about all of you. I work with thousands of people around the globe, and I'm seeing more anger, more fear, more grief. Anybody else seeing that in your patients coming in to see you? It's rampant, and these are the emotional side effects of toxicities and then how somebody's going to work with those toxicities. So let me see if I can go the right way here. There we go. So I'm a functional nutritionist, and I'm owner and founder of Replenish PDX, which is a virtual clinic. Like I said, we work with people around the globe. And I'm also owner and founder of Holistic Nutrition Lab, which is a school teaching the science and the art of functional nutrition to practitioners also around the globe, 41 countries now. But I like to say that I'm actually a patient advocate. And I'm a patient advocate for the patient with chronic illness. And they don't have patient advocates. We are their patient advocates. They do not have enough support. This started for me with my husband's illness. He was diagnosed with a brain tumor, a glioblastoma multiforme, back in April of 2000. And during the 2.5 years that he lived with that diagnosis, we had many different doctors, and it was really important to be an advocate for him to learn how to be his own advocate. And I'm experiencing this now with my father, speaking about the stress of father's illnesses. My dad was diagnosed with a B-cell lymphoma, but as they start to look inside, they find in a 79-year-old man all sorts of issues. So we have the gastroenterologist, we have the pulmonologist, we have the oncologist, we have the surgeon, and nobody's dictating or controlling care. There's not one person to be the advocate, and the family has fortunately handed that over to me so that I can just try to assemble the care, and I'm left thinking, what happens when we're not there, when families don't have people like us to work with? So I really am a stand for patient advocacy. And that brings me to the hero's journey, which I spoke about last time I was here in June. And when we have toxic patients, when we have patients who are ill, they are called to the adventure of getting well. And if you see, step two in this process is the assistance, and it's our assistance. But what we have to understand is that they're going to have to make a departure from the reality that they know to be true right now. And change takes courage. Change takes courage. And what we do is we bring the assistance to them so that they can find that courage, so that they can go through the trials, they can find a new approach. They're going to hit crises, and we need to be able to help them through those crises. And what I find with too many patients is that they're stuck in the victim section of the victim accountability loop. And this is a diagram that I learned from a business coach, Annie Hyman Pratt, but I thought it really applied well to what we experience with our clients and patients. So every situation has a choice. We have a choice to make in every situation. But if we're lacking the intention, we miss the point. And what we'll see with people is that to begin with, they may be in the ignore place. They don't want to know that they have a problem. Then they're going to deny that they have to make a change. They might blame their environment, their parents, you, for asking them to make change. They'll rationalize the ways that they're continuing to behave. They'll resist making the changes that you want, and then they'll hide. They won't come back and see you. But this is where we go to the hero's journey, and you provide assistance, because what you can help them do is recognize. And recognition is the first step in accountability. So if we can recognize where they are, we can build a better bridge. And really, a lot of what I'm going to be teaching in this new year is about empathy. It's about how we build a bridge to our most toxic patients and keep ourselves safe and sane in the process, because they're not always nice when they're going through detoxification. So as we come into accountability, we really can recognize where we need to make a change. We can own the situation. We can forgive our faults or the lifestyles that got us to this point. We can really start to self-examine. This is the place where we start to see differences with our patients and clients. When they're really beginning to look at their behaviors and self-examining, they learn and they take action. But if we can recognize where they are, we can help them recognize for that. We can help them bring to recognition where they are. So what I like to play with here is what I call the client or patient's outcome and vision. What is it that they want to achieve? And they may come to you saying that they want to lose weight, that they have resistant weight loss and they want to lose weight. And they've done everything. In fact, we see the patients that have been everywhere and done everything. They're down to eating like 10 foods because they've already eliminated everything because they're so symptomatic. And they say they still want to lose weight and they're trying everything. So you, as a functional practitioner, identify thyroid issues, you identify estrogen dominance, and you figure out, I know what I'm going to do here. I'm going to develop all these things that are part of their plan and their protocol, the detoxification program that includes sleep and relaxation and breathing and exercise, and I've got their diet that's going to help their liver function. I'm going to bring in the methylated folate so that the detox organs are functioning better, and we've got this whole plan, we've got the whole detox planned out for them, but what we have to recognize is that it's not our outcome in vision. We might see estrogen dominance as the issue and a detox needed for estrogen dominance, but that's our idea of what needs to happen from a physiological level. What we need to do to provide assistance is connect it with the patient's outcome in vision. And that might take some digging and some work. They may say they want to lose weight, but we need to figure out, what do they want to lose weight for? What is it that they want to do? They want to have better memory so that they can achieve more in their work, or they want to lose weight so they can be out with their grandchildren. They want to be able to run around and be mobile and not be in pain. Then we start to make the connections of, if this, then your outcome and vision. Not my outcome and vision, but your outcome and vision. And if we start to develop the skills or the program without understanding their outcome and vision, we're in the shadow side, and it's harder for them to make the changes. Remember, change takes courage. So this is the matrix that I use in practice and that I teach in my training. It's adapted from the Institute of Functional Medicine's matrix. And if you look over on the left side there, those are the skills. And I borrow this from my friend Dr. David Hazy. This is the story, the soup, which is the physiology, and the skills. And as functional practitioners, we can get really caught in the soup, just looking and looking for where the physiological imbalances lie, and we can get stuck down rabbit holes of trying to figure it all out. But there's a lot of information for us in the story. What are the antecedents, the triggers, and the mediators? How is this person responding to everything in their life? And as we start to put them together, the skills are then not in violation of the whole person. We get to see the story and the soup. And I think we have to break the story down even further. And this is what we do in ancient medicine. This is the Chinese five elements. I was speaking with a friend of mine the other day who's a professor of immunology and dean of research at the National College of Naturopathic Medicine in Portland. And she goes all over the world studying different cultures and their ancient forms of medicine. And we were having tea talking about, what's the missing piece? What did the Western medicine lose along the way? And one thing we talked about was, we've lost constitution. We've lost the person's constitution along the way. So if we look at Chinese five elements as an example where they connect organs of the body to emotions, to seasons, we can look at the large intestines, where we release, and our lungs, as associated with grief. When somebody's having respiratory issues or issues with their colon, do we see issues of grief? Can we suspect, when someone's stuck in an issue of grief, that they may have issues in these detoxification organs? When it comes to this season, where we're looking at the kidneys connected to the adrenals, we're seeing the season that's water and fear, a lot of fear coming up in this season. We move into the liver, the biggest detoxification organ, biggest internal detoxification organ, and we see anger. And when you start to bring people through a liver detox, anger is what's going to come up. Fire is our small intestine, our pericardium, our heart protector, all our barrier systems. So when we have hyperpermeability, what might we be seeing with fire and somebody's propensity for overjoyousness? And earth, the fifth element, often overlooked, the spleen and stomach, is associated with worry. So this is my constitutional factor, and I have Hashimoto's. I have hyperpermeability in several areas, but what I've learned in being somebody who has this as my constitutional factor is that I need a ring, a protector for me. So what I like to teach my clients and my students is how we actually have a space that we fill. And this is how we start to work in our practices and with our most toxic clients. So imagine, if you will, a queen sitting on a throne, and she has her queendom, with guards at the gate that can come into her area or not. And those guards are meant to protect her. They're meant to either let people in that are appropriate to come in or keep people out. And what you'll find with many of your clients is that they're usually hyperpermeable. They're getting upset by things in their space too often, or they can't receive feedback or information. And this tells you that they can start working on their permeability, on the guards at the gate. So I love that we can use different principles, different modalities. The beauty of functional medicine is that it's the map, it's the GPS, and we can then bring any modalities into work into that map, and it helps us see balance. So I'm a big fan, if you haven't been able to tell already, of frameworks and systems so we can problem solve on the spot. And this is another system that I learned, or framework that I learned from Annie Hyman-Pratt. And she talks about how we move from the current state to the transformed state, which is what we're all trying to do with our patients. And there are a few truths about this. Number one, once you step off of A, you can't ever go back to A. Number two, the road from A to B is never a straight line. And this is what it's going to look like in practice. We are always trying to figure out what's next and determining based on a response where we need to go. So it's going to look a little wonky. And if we can prep our clients and patients for that reality, then they're in it with us. And the third point is that as we get closer to that transformed state, the level of excellence narrows. We begin to see more clearly where we need to go. So helping people understand this process lets them know that it's not a one-time thing. It's not just one shot that we're going for. Oops, went the wrong way. So I talked a little bit about how I'm leading with empathy. This is what I'm now calling the practitioner's mastery matrix. And what I've seen in working with thousands of practitioners is that people get stuck in these 3, 4, 5 areas, and they're not actually able to retain clients or patients or solve the problems. And it takes some other key areas to be able to really work with empathy and with success. So this is the practitioner empathy matrix that I'll be teaching into in the next year. And I'd love to invite you all to move into empathy with me. I've developed an entire empathy matrix that shows us what's happening. What are the insults that are happening to the body, and then who is it that's responding? So for all my students, it's what's going on in there and who's it going on to, so or in or with. So you can learn more about the empathy matrix, get your first of the 3 handouts in the empathy matrix at holisticnutritionlab.com/functional. And I think this is an important conversation for us all to have. How do we bring empathy and constitution back into the practice, especially when we're working with people who are highly toxic, because they're gonna be in emotional states of disrupt. So thank you very much, and I look forward to talking with you more about empathy in the coming year.
All right, so Andrea is going to be joining us on our panel with also Penelope and Dr. Morrison, and also my co-founder at the Evolution of Medicine, Gabe Hoffman. So let's give everyone a round of applause and get them to come up here on stage. While they're coming up, I just want to give a little bit of a shout out, and you guys can come and join, turn on your microphones, and we'll start here. I just want to give a quick shout out to our Facebook page, because if you've been following in the last couple days, you would have seen Dr. Rangan Chatterjee's talk from the event that we did back in September, where he was our keynote at ABC Home. No one else has actually seen that because it was recorded for potentially a PBS special that's going to be coming out in April. But we put Dr. Chatterjee's talk on there about being the doctor of the future, and I highly recommend you watch that. But on Saturday, I shared a quote on empathy that I came across, and I thought, in the spirit of what you just said, I just pulled it up. I thought that this would be interesting for everyone. He says, sympathy is easy. This is a quote from Dennis Lehane. He says, sympathy is easy. You have sympathy for starving children swatting at flies on the late night commercials. Sympathy is easy because it comes from a position of power. Empathy is getting down on your knees and looking someone else in the eye and realizing you could be them, and all that separates you is luck. I thought that was a really awesome quote. So, the year of empathy, 2016, Andrea. I quite like that. I might have to steal that. Dr. Morrison, I want to talk to you about the lymph system here for a moment before we get into the Twitter questions, because I interviewed Dr. Ron Hoffman, and he told me that MDs generally don't get a lot of training about the lymph, and it seems like this is kind of a key player in this whole detox process. I'm not talking about just your running, but generally the lymph is a key player here. How much education are MDs getting in the lymph, and how important player is it in detoxification?
I don't believe I received any education in medical school on lymphatic drainage, and I learned most of my knowledge about this by my naturopathic colleagues and friends. They're the ones that sort of brought me up to date on what it means. Yeah, it was actually kind of nebulous at first. I didn't even understand like what they were talking about, but it's really important. I mean, that's really our storage organ. It's like, of course, fat is a place to store toxins, but so is the space in between all the cells. And when our body is not detox, when we sort of get too much exposure and we are no longer able to get the toxins out of our system the way that we're supposed to, these toxins have to go someplace. And while some people are lucky enough to store it in fat where they don't get symptoms, if it goes into the interstitial space where the cells are not able to manage it and it won't go into circulation for liver and kidney to get rid of it, then we really have a big problem. And the people with interstitial spacing problems usually have fluid retention, that like weight loss that they just can't get rid of, and a lot of inflammation. So,
Andrea, what do you do with lymph in your program?
We definitely talk about lymph in the immune intensive. We like to look at breathing techniques, rebounding. What else comes to mind? I can call on my students and give them quizzes.
Live quiz. You didn't know there'd be a test, otherwise you wouldn't have had the detox shake outside, which had vodka in it. All right, so we're going to just have a couple of questions here from Twitter, and then audience, put your hand up if you want to ask a question. I'll send the mic over to you. Dr. Ellie Campbell has a question, and she's from Atlanta. She runs our Atlanta meetup, which is a big, consistent meetup. I'm a big fan of her. She says about detox during pregnancy, too many pregnant moms with overwhelming nausea is, if toxic and pregnant, how do you help people? And I'll direct that maybe to Jeff first. And then I'm sure, Penelope, you may have a question about this. Because didn't you give your TED talk while you were pregnant?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
I'm a pregnant woman to ever give a TED talk. Okay, there you go. That's
my claim
to fame.
Well, do you want to start? I mean, you've probably talked to people about this. Okay, Jeff, you want to start?
Obviously, our first rule is that we don't want to detoxify a person while they're pregnant, because a lot of those toxins are going to be mobilized and go into the fetus. The placenta is actually a very good detoxifying organ. So basically what is not going out of the woman's body can go into the fetus. And so probably just the best way to start out with, and I'd love everybody else's opinion, but just making sure that the exhaust system's working, getting all the toxins out through the back end.
Okay. Andrea, you want to add to that?
Yeah, I definitely, I've led a lot of cleanses and detoxes and always have pregnant women in them. And what we have to do is make sure everything's working functionally first. There isn't constipation, but also slow it down quite a bit. So I think it depends on what we mean by detox and cleanse. And I like to lead food-based detoxes and cleanses, so they're slow enough that there isn't a lot of toxic dumping, but of course, supporting the body and all the detoxification organs.
Jeff, I like what you said there about using the word detox and that idea to just sort of trick people into lifestyle change, which isn't as sexy as maybe doing a detox. Is that something that you sort of consciously did, or have you just arrived that that's a good sort of energizing factor for people?
Well, I think just about everything I'm doing is tricking people into doing something. It's somehow they arrive in my across the desk from me, and they're like, I want to get here, and secretly I have to help them to get over here. So, which is exactly what you were saying, which I really appreciated. So.
Penelope, what are your thoughts? Pregnancy, detoxification? I'd love to hear your thoughts.
I'm sure you can imagine I could talk all night about this.
Well, give it a go.
But this is absolutely true. The idea that you are, in fact, carrying everything that's going to pass into this baby, and you want to be very careful about what you do have circulating. You don't want to release anything. So, for example, when you're pregnant, your body is basically searching for calcium. A lot of calcium gets leached and it releases lead. So making sure that you're not calcium deficient is really helpful. You don't want to deliberately go through that process and say, well, hey, you know, this is actually the most perfect time to do that. Your baby will detoxify you. In fact, studies have shown that having a baby and breastfeeding leads to much less toxicity for the mother. Unfortunately, we know where it's going.
Yeah.
And so that
it's not a net win.
No, not for anyone. I think, you know, encouraging pregnant women to certainly look at their diet, to eat well. We know that there's been a great study out of Duke that shows that leafy green vegetables like spinach are really good in dealing with the effects of things like BPA, for example. So cleaning up diet, meeting toxicity where it comes from and trying to rectify it there. Moving, you know, pregnant women can move, they can exercise, they can be healthy, and they can support the process in that way. But, you know, actively, aggressively detoxing, really, it's not the time to do it.
Interesting. Gabe, you know, you one of the things I think really put the Functional Forum on a good standing point in the beginning was I had an opportunity to speak to 1,000 doctors before I got into this, just to start this. And I know in the last year you've spoken to probably 1,000 doctors being in the concierge program. How do the particularly, I'd love to know your thoughts about how doctors who are sort of making the switch across from regular medicine to integrated medicine view this topic, and what are some of the opportunities for them to be able to use this as a way to sort of move into this space?
Yeah, sure. Well, you know, first off, detoxing and cleansing is one of these buzzwords. It's in every blog. It's in every, you know, people are talking about it. So, you know, the doctors that are first coming across and coming on board, a lot of times, you know, they want to bring these into their center. What I really appreciated about it, and something you know, people have seen us talk about here at the forum, is it's so much about building community and leveraging your time. You know, the so many skilled practitioners and doctors out there that could do great work, but aren't necessarily running their practice in a way that's going to make sense for them. So, like, what we're really passionate about is how can we help empower the doctors, the MDs, the naturopaths, the practitioners of today to leverage their time, because you're not just a doctor, you're a teacher, right? You're teaching people how to change their lifestyle. You're teaching people how to take care of themselves. And so the reason I'm saying all this is because a detox program is one of the best ways to start to integrate and implement that approach into your practice. You know, a group cleanse or a group detox is great, not just because it leverages financially, but because you can incorporate your health coach, you can incorporate other members of your staff, you can get in front of a group of people and teach something, you can get the people coming into your office to know each other and to start talking to each other as support buddies. So it's a great way to introduce them to the concept of how you would want to run that type of scalable office, and you get great results like that, and it becomes a much more fun experience. I think something about, you know, when we're all together at this event every month, it's a lot of fun. That's why people come back. It's not just to hear James talk or us talk or a few people. James thinks it's to hear him talk, but overall, it's a mix of everyone having a good time. So, you know, the more you can create that at your office, the more you're going to have a community hub, and I think detoxing and cleansing is one of the smartest ways to do that.
You know, that's a great point that you made there, that it's not, you know, the detoxification, yes, is like improving the function of detoxification organs, but the majority of the leverage is not putting the toxins in the first place. And so that requires, again, that's not a medical thing, that's a community thing, that's a behavior change thing.
Right.
What are some of the ways that you're seeing that people are doing that out in the field at scale?
Well, it's a great point. So if I were to answer that question about pregnancy, I think, you know, one of the basic things is women just avoiding all of these things, because obviously what they're putting in is going to the baby. So cleansing, we know, could be dangerous. And as a practitioner who was not a doctor, I always had to be extremely careful what I would do. So in that situation, it's always just about eliminating things. And then you're right, the next question is, okay, yeah, so I just eliminate everything that I use in my day-to-day lifestyle, just do that tomorrow. You know, like, no one could do that. And basically, that's the biggest challenge. So when you have people working together and you've created a community, and it's not just you sitting with someone in one-on-one saying, here's your plan, here's what you have to do, see you in 2 months, but you actually have a group of people getting together who are supporting each other, and then it's like, hey, are you having trouble with this part of the program, or how are you doing, what are you using in place of your soap or whatever thing you were using that had chemicals, and everyone's helping each other with that. That's how they actually execute this plan. You know, we have so many great plans, but the truth is the challenge is, how do you help someone when they leave your office to change their entire lifestyle? And it doesn't happen overnight, and it doesn't happen just because you think it's a good idea. It happens because they're motivated, and they also have a continuous day-to-day support of some kind, whether it's within the family or you know, something you're providing in your center, or a health coach, or but we need to, or just a buddy, you know, like, and I don't know if you've done this in your office this way, but just having other patients work together and just support each other. So I feel like building community around cleanses is a really smart approach.
And good timing coming up towards that. Andrea, you're training a lot of practitioners to do this, and coaches maybe, and other practitioners. How are you teaching them to change this this habit?
Change the habit of toxicity?
Well, just whatever it takes. You know, they're retoxifying themselves through all kinds of things all the time, right?
Yeah, so the first module in my training is the digestive intensive, and we need those organs functioning properly so we can even get to the liver. So in the digestive intensive, we actually have the liver bonus, which tends to be a crowd favorite amongst my students because they're finally getting to understand the genetic polymorphisms and all these things that people are coming to us with. So I think it's that deeper understanding of what's going on in there, understanding from a coaching perspective how we can relate what we're seeing to what might be happening, and then how we actually turn around and work with the individual who's experiencing that.
Penelope, what are some of the ways that you have seen that you've been able to sort of get the word out to a lot of people in the right time and sort of scale the communication aspect of it, apart from your TED talk, which is awesome again?
Well, I find that people are increasingly motivated to want to know about this. And I think social media has been a really important tool in the word getting out. You know, I think what we probably all appreciate is that the internet is a weird and wonderful place. Yeah. And there is a lot of weirdness. I'm sure there are many practitioners who get people turning up in their office going, well, I read this, and this is how you do a detox. And you know, it's an amazing tool. I think that if we can get people to understand that as a functional practitioner, you are on board, you're looking at the studies, you're with the data, then they're more inclined to trust you. They're more inclined to interact on social media with their friends, within their communities. I have a great doctor. I mean, what I hear a lot of is my doctor has no idea what I'm talking about. And I hear that more than anything else. My doctor tells me I'm crazy. My child is really sick, and my doctor won't, and he doesn't know it, and he has 5 minutes for me, and blah, 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 blah. And I think that in terms of, like, where am I seeing my work being sort of magnified out, it's when people feel like there's someone of authority that they can speak to that reinforces the instincts that they have that this isn't right. I'm not meant to be this sick. You know, when I was growing up, kids weren't sick like this. Why is my kid so sick? Or my peers weren't always so ill. And I think that that is a really important tool if we have the practitioners there to lead them.
Awesome. Okay, we'll take a few questions from the crowd here. I'll start with Martha. Martha Cortez, dentist. Dentists have been poisoning people for a while, so, you know, good time for a question.
Agreed. Okay. So actually, speaking about children, so I have three generations in the practice because I end up having the grandmothers bring the daughters, bring the children. They're preparing for pregnancy. And they go, oh, I'm going to be pregnant in 3 months. I go, and you have mercury fillings in your mouth and you want me to detox your mercury fillings. 3 months is not enough.
No.
Not at all. And then they had the children when they had the mercury, so now the kids have a little ADD, a little autism, just a touch, just a spectrum. So now we're supposed to detox that generation. But meantime, they're not breathing very well. The adenoids are an issue. The lymph is a tissue. Their posture is overburdened. And then grandma's the one who's cleanest out of everybody and grandpa because they've been with the practice.
Absolutely.
So where do you start? Start with, because the mother is the generation of three generations.
Yeah. So.
So where do you start?
That's a great question. I think you have to start with the children because they're still developing.
And their airway.
And their airways. I mean, you know, being the quality of breath is so important when you're growing up. I think, you know, we focus a lot on pregnancy, of course. So much of your adult mechanisms are being laid down during that time. But during childhood, you still have a lot of developmental processing going on. So I think you really want to try and help that child because implications in childhood are felt in adulthood. I think empowering grandma and granddad to help mom and dad is really, really key because mom and dad just, they are so stressed and they are like, beyond, and then they're finding out, oh, you mean it's my mercury fillings that cause this? I mean, the kind of guilt that they have to deal with.
Or they took it out too soon.
So what I did wasn't good enough. You mean I should have waited even more? Like, what more do I need to do? Like, how much more of a superwoman? I mean, it's a really heavy burden, and I feel like supporting them is really key.
Andrea, you want to add to that?
Yeah, I would love to. I think that we have to look at where people have motivation and what the motivating factors are because change is hard. And I think pregnancy is a brilliant time because people are motivated at that time. They're scared prior to, but that's happening more. I'm seeing people going in and there's more education about the months or the year prior to conception. So because pregnancy is coming also with fertility issues. Mm-hmm. There is more preparation, and it's a great motivating time. I think it's a perfect way to target a population to have this important conversation. Mm-hmm.
I also think that if you have a woman of childbearing age, this is information that they should have because a lot of people accidentally get pregnant, or you're on the other side of the fence where you've put it off for so long and then suddenly the alarm is going, and it's like, I want to have a baby tomorrow. And I think if you're already thinking about it, you know, just so you know, you might want to start thinking about these things. There might be little things that they can do, even though they're not necessarily thinking they want to get pregnant tomorrow.
Good stuff. Yeah, I'm loving the group of different types of practitioners in here. We've got dentists asking questions. Dr. Datner, holistic dermatologist.
Thank you. I think one of the great things that may come out of this work is getting the word around. One of the things I had the privilege to do was write an article on breastfeeding and eczema. And as a result, I got to review a number of articles in the medical literature that were about to come out, some of which I found horrific and fought tooth and nail. And the basic finding was that there was a lot of, in the early literature, there were small studies and certainly a general feeling that if women breastfed, the children had less eczema and less allergies. Mm. But the later study and the studies that were coming out since, you know, the past 5 years or so were much bigger studies and showing just the opposite, were very mixed results. And only the most horrific eczema patients were protected by breastfeeding, and the rest of them, it was a very mixed bag. Mm. And I think what we have is a situation like you've all been discussing. Here we have probably leaky gut leading to toxicity, leading to ototoxicity from allergens, from not only food that's not broken down completely, but also to toxins from the colon, which if you don't have that valve closed, you get backup, and people are really getting a huge blast. So I think it's really important to start trying to get the word out there that women have to start beforehand. You just like you don't want an accidental pregnancy for financial, political, and relationship reasons. You really don't want an accidental pregnancy for detox reasons. And as a physician, as an MD, I don't even give supplements to women who are pregnant because if anything goes wrong, now maybe you can get away with it as coaches, but as a physician, if anything goes wrong, you're going to get blamed and you probably wind up in court. So from the standpoint of what makes sense, you know that some of those people who you detox are going to pull toxins out of privileged sites, like mercury out of the kidney and out of the liver and start floating that around. You don't really want that to happen during pregnancy. It just doesn't make any sense. So I think this is terrific that you're all discussing this. I just wanted to add the other point about the fixing the gut. And the flora and the leakiness before somebody gets pregnant. And this is, again, as you said, if you want to get pregnant tomorrow, I fight with women, say, you know, give me 3 months.
Yeah.
It's not going to happen overnight. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Dantner. Do you have another question here at the front?
Hi, Paul Grewal. I'm a internist, allopathic, I suppose one would call it. It's a bit of a four-letter word around here. Forgive me if this turns into more of a comment than a question, but it's directed at Andrea. So I left hospital medicine a few months ago and started my own practice. And what I found is that when you talk about empathy, my kind of definition of empathy is that I suffer when I see somebody else suffer. And I think part of the traditional medical training and the everything that you go through drives that out of you because of the time pressures. I think it's really, and you know, I also had kind of my own health journey of being very overweight. And so being able to see that in somebody else, when I see another physician who's a string bean, and forgive Dr. Morrison, you're very lithe.
I'm trying to put on weight.
when I see them preach to a patient or label them as non-compliant, I think it's far and away the worst thing a doctor could ever do in terms of dismissing a patient because, you know, their hormones are screwed up. They're insulin resistant, even if they wanted to eat. I was driven out of my hospital system for instituting a low carbohydrate diet for metabolic syndrome patients. This is not the ADA recommendation. Sorry, you can't keep doing this. And I had patients come into my clinic where it was high fives 3 months later instead of let's go through your med list again. I think it's the whole kind of functional sort of paradigm, I think, has to stay focused on empathy above everything else, because that is what differentiates it. And it also allows you to get that connection with the patient to drive behavior change.
And trust.
Yes.
Because the behavior change is going to come from trust. And I think I really appreciate what you're saying. And also, I think a lot of practitioners are fearful of empathy because of that barrier I was talking about with the queen and the guards. We need some protection for ourselves. So what I'm actually looking at are what are three stages that we can look at in empathy, and I'm looking at inquire and identify and integrate. So the inquiry is really asking the questions so we can be with the person and appreciate who they are. Identifying is seeing them, really, who is this that I'm working with? And how do we then integrate what we learn from those processes into our care? So there's a little bit of selfishness for me in the empathy. One is really to see the patient, but I feel like when we're in an empathetic state, not only is there oxytocin flowing and there's more trust in there for both of us in the therapeutic relationship, but we actually garner more information that's going to give us more clues. So instead of just jumping to the conclusion, when we develop that trust and that empathy, that's when the magic comes in, and we get, if we're able to be in confidence and think on our feet, we get the answers that we need because they hold them all. So I really appreciate what you're saying, and I think in allopathic medicine, there is a lot of fear of empathy because we don't want to take on their pain. So how do we practice in empathy without bombarding ourselves?
Quit your job at the hospital.
Gabe, you want to add something to that?
Yeah, I think with the empathy topic, a big part of it, it's not just about feeling each other's pain, it's about seeing each other as capable. So, you know, I think a lot of when you feel the pain someone's feeling and you feel the helplessness that they're feeling, I think you're moving away from empathy and more into a sympathy or more into this helplessness with them. When you feel their pain but also see them as capable, it really changes the position. So, you know, what's interesting is all the information, like what was just brought up. So here's this woman, she's had a child, she was toxic when she had the child, now she feels guilty for having done it. So, you know, and at the same time, there are people who haven't gotten pregnant yet who need to understand that this is an important factor of having a baby. So how do we educate those people, but then also let the people know who've already had kids that it's okay. Here's where your step is now. Because the most important thing is that we have a population of empowered people who feel like whatever it is that's on their plate now, they can take on. Whereas, you know, so much about learning about the mistakes we've made in the past just triggers old traumas of just all the mistakes we've made in the past and all the things we can't go back and change. And, you know, it's a it can create a helpless feeling. So I think we have to balance, you know, educating the young woman who hasn't gotten pregnant yet with educating the mother who already has had a baby and letting her know it's okay too, and here's where your steps are, and this person's steps are different, but that overall everyone is capable of handling whatever it is they have. And I think that's, you know, a more well-rounded version of it.
I was going to end there, but Kelly B wants to say something in the front. What are you going to say?
No, I think it's such a relevant consideration because there's a shaming component, right? So I always invoke the Maya Angelou quote that I knew, you know, I did then what I knew how to do, and now that I know better, I do better. And it's essentially like a, you know, it's a forgiveness and compassionate sort of oriented posture you can adopt while also saying, now you know, so do differently.
Yeah, right. Yeah, I mean, I completely agree. And
I just want to say thanks, Paul. Thanks so much for coming. I really appreciate it. You're the most important person here in a certain way, because this whole Evolution of Medicine project was really designed to, you know, really make it easy for people to sort of, you know, understand that this is something that's necessary and valuable. And I really appreciate you coming today and being part of it. I do want to say, with regard, one thing that we did earlier this year that I think is going to come full circle, we interviewed Dr. Pamela Weibel for our podcast on the micropractice evolution. She, by all intents and purposes, and from whatever I've heard, absolutely crushed it at TED Med a few weeks ago. And I think when her talk comes out, but she was basically talking about the fact that medical school is an abusive relationship. And people come out of that abusive relationship doing things that they probably wouldn't do otherwise. Yeah, exactly. And I think that this is really getting to the core of what's going to happen. So that TED Med talk is going to come out. If you go back through our podcast and listen to her, I think she's a superstar in the making with that. I also want to mention, I know that there's a lot of amazing people in this room, and there's people at home listening. One thing that we're going to do in 2016, we're going to give everyone every opportunity, anyone who's in this community, anyone who watches, an opportunity to add their content to this show. We know that there are tons of doctors that are probably sitting at home going, oh, I wish I'd been able to say this or that. You're going to be able to say it, and we're going to put it on the show. We want to engage the power of the whole community all over the world. Anyone can make a video with their smartphone now, and that's going to be one of the things that we're going to do next year. I'd like to just let everyone know that January 4th is our next functional forum. Chema Wellness is going to be hosting one here. You've all got the flyers here in New York. We're going to be coming live from Orange County, California. It's called Functional Neuropsychiatry. We've got Dr. Hyla Kass, Dr. Datis Karazian, and some other legends. We're going to tap the talent of the whole country and bring them all to you every month. Thanks so much for, it's been a great run here in New York. The last 2 years have been amazing. Everything has come because of the community that we built here. We want to take this and make it bigger. We're going to do some epic things in 2016. Watch this space. I would say, if you want to come and hang out with us, if you're watching at home and you want to come and hang out with us, come and go skiing the weekend of the 30th and 31st of January, and then come to the Functional Forum on February 1st in Boulder, Colorado. We've got a great lineup. Jill Carnahan's going to speak. Mark David is going to speak. We've got a good group coming up there. I'd like everyone here to give a warm round of applause to our panel. Thanks so much for being here. This has been the Functional Forum. We'll see you next time. Thank you.